Good evening, friends. I, on behalf of Beyond Law CLC and Shobhit University Merit, welcome you all. Another part of our series on gender sensitization. And today the topic is a journey into diverse facets of domestic violence. Amongst us, we have three speakers, that is Honorable Ms. Justice Moshmi Bhattacharya, judge from Calcutta High Court, Honorable Mrs. Justice Roshan Dalvi, a former judge of Bombay High Court, and Honorable Ms. Justice Dr. Shalini Phansalkar Joshi, a former judge of Bombay High Court. As we all know that all these three judges have a deep interest in women's rights, gender and equality issues, and they, especially during these COVID times, the domestic violence has carried its in a different dimension and different facets. I'm not taking all of you to much, we can speak much about the speakers as such, but since we know that there are three speakers and the topic is quite diverse, I would be straight away requesting the speakers to take on the platform. The questions can be posted on the chat box, but preferably it should be after 5:40, so that because invariably we will be touching that base. It can be in fact going beyond that also. But questions should be restrained to the topic of domestic violence. And the other comments should also be restrained so that the hygiene of the platform is maintained as such. We have tried that while discussing and taking this issue that there is no as such overlapping of the issues because the, as I earlier said, that the issue is quite diverse and we want that we can make best use of the speakers who have happily agreed to come on this platform. Over to you, Justice Moshmi Bhattacharya. It gives us pleasure that all three of you come again on our platform. We are all highly proud and feel happy that you have accepted. Over to you, Justice Moshmi.
Thank you, Mr. Chhatru. Very good evening to all of you who are who have tuned in onto this webinar. And a very good evening to my esteemed panelists, Justice Joshi, Justice Dalvi. I really hope to enjoy this webinar with your informed views on the subject. So just to make the topic, snappy and interesting and not kind of meandering, I've decided to give a broad outline of what domestic violence is really all about, because we may know about the act as such, but there are many things in the act which I myself, on a personal note, discovered when I was going through it. So I just thought it would be interesting for me to bring those points to your for your information. I would go on then to some of the recent decisions of the Supreme Court 2018 to 2020, which in my view are important. The decisions are important because they really would give you an outline or the arc of development of the Act and the way its provisions, particularly sections 2 and 3, and I'll come to what sections 2 and 3 are in a moment, have been interpreted by the Supreme Court, and they have really developed, resulted in a development of the law, which is very important. And lastly, a very quick look at the gaps in the Act, if I may put it that way. The Act, what are the situations which have not really been looked into or which may not have been contemplated by the legislature? As you know, any act, any enactment is as good as the test of time which it withstands. So any act would remain relevant with the dynamics of time, with the way society changes, with the way societal perceptions change. So in that sense, I would like to point out certain places in the act where probably the time has come to take a relook. And the last point, again, a very quick look at a possible neutrality area, because I am aware as a woman that these kinds of legislations are actually, fortunately for us, always given the look of, taken through the prism of equality. Whether these enactments, which are pronouncedly, markedly in favor of women, for women, and I would probably like to view some sections as by women in all probability, whether they really stand the test of constitutional equality, whether it's Article 14, whether it's a general sense of equity. So that is the last portion. So without any further delay, let me go to the first point of which I propose to deal with today. That is, what was the reference point to the Act? Now, the Act is, the full form is Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act 2005. So where do we get the reference point to this particular legislation? The, as many of you may already know, the precursors to this act was really the Dowry Prohibition Act of 1961, which made the act of giving and receiving dowry a crime. There were sections 498A and section 304B of the IPC code. That was, of course, introduced in 1983 and 1986, if I'm not mistaken. Then the next development was March 2013, more correctly, 19th March 2013, when the Indian Parliament passed a new law with the goal of protecting women from sexual violence. And that came in the form of a Criminal Law Amendment Act of 2013, of the Criminal Law Amendment Act of 2013, which amended the IPC. Not only the IPC, actually the Code of Criminal Procedure 73, as well as the Indian Evidence Act of 1872. And the most recent legislation, which is of note, is what we popularly call the POCSO, the Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act 2012. That is really a very relevant piece of legislation now. So if the idea was to give you a very brief precursors, brief look at what went before this act came into existence in 2005. And the next thing, seamlessly leading on to, is what is this act? So apart from section 498A of the IPC, which was a primary section which governed cruelty against women, the Domestic Violence Act of 2005 really broadened the field and made it much wider, so that even the concept of what can be termed as cruelty or any kind of behavior which would come under the broad umbrella of cruelty came to be included under the under this act. And what does the act seek to do? The Act, to put it very simply, seeks to cover those women who are or have been in a relationship with the abuser, quote unquote, that's from the Act itself, and where both parties have lived together in a shared household, within quotation marks from the Act, and are related by either marriage or a relationship in the nature of marriage, or adoption, or consanguinity, or a relationship where family members live together in the form of a joint family. Every possible situation, but there has to be a relationship, or a relationship which would include the victim, the woman, and the abuser, to share a common space, to share a shared household in that sense. And the interesting part is that when I say joint family, it would include, it would bring in its fold everyone, you name it, sisters, widows, mothers, single women, or anyone living with them. So really, the compass of who a victim can be was really, you know, given a very, very broad canvas. But then what's new? What's new about the Act? How can we say, or can we say at all, that the 2005 Act is an intervention? I'll just give you the pointers, and it is up to you to decide whether it is an intervention or not. When I was going through the Act and, you know, the recent decisions, one of the first things which struck me was that what the Act really protects is the woman's right to secure housing. The Act actually protects the right of a woman to reside in the matrimonial or shared household, whether or not she has any title to that house or any rights in the household. The Act actually gives the woman the right to have to stay in the shared household, which we can say is a residence order. Secondly, what the law, the Act looks at and tries to prevent are all kinds of, you know, conceivable acts which can really cause harm to a woman, not only physical harm, but any kind of mental, emotional, economic harm as well. So what would these acts be? What does the Act seek to protect? Things like stalking, voyeurism, acid attacks, disrobing a woman, or anything which would cause her, which would harm her physical integrity of the body. And what is the punishment? It actually provides capital punishment for things like rape, which leads to death, and gang rapes, etc., even committed by a police officer, by the armed forces. So everybody is taken into the fold of who an abuser can be. The other relief which the Act looks at and provides some sort of a relief is to pass a protection order which would prevent an abuser from aiding or committing an act of domestic violence. You know, so it's not really that the Act has to be committed, but any kind of facilitating that act is also taken into account by the statute, by the legislation. And when we talk about economic offense, what would that be? So any kind of act from which the woman is deprived of, from her assets, or taking the woman away from her assets, or seeing to it that the woman does not have access to assets or property, that would also be termed and come under the umbrella of abuse, economic abuse in this sense. And the Act actually provides different mechanisms for the purpose of reporting the incidents. You know, this, I think, is a very important feature of the Act, because the very expression domestic violence, and when I kept reiterating the concept of a shared household, the recurring image one gets is an abuse, a commission of an offense or an omission also within the four walls of a house. So how does one get to know that, you know, something like this has even happened to a woman within the house? I mean, after all, the house is really the traditional and the historical way of looking at a house and a household is a sanctum sanctorum, in that sense that anything which happens within its walls is private, is of a private nature. So how does one get to know that something like this has really taken place in the first place? So the Act provides for various ways of reporting. And who can report? So A, obviously the aggrieved person, the person who has suffered the assault or the abuse, the violence. B is any protection officer, that also comes from the Act, any protection officer who can take the complaint to the proper authorities on behalf of the aggrieved person. And or three, any person who has been, explicitly or even implicitly authorized by the aggrieved person, even any kind of authorization is not even necessary. You know, any person who is a friend who comes to know, you know, through a WhatsApp message, through a phone call, a text message, can go and take the complaint forward. And what are the kinds of protection orders which can be passed by a magistrate? A, residence orders. B, monetary relief. 3, custody orders. And 4, compensation in the form of money or any kind of restitution, which seeks to make good the loss which has been suffered by the victim. So quickly to the next part, what are the 5 pillars on which this act is based? And for that, if I may just quickly look at the statement of objects and reasons of the 2005 Act, which really mentions what this act has looked to inspiration for. And that is, it says that, interesting, the way it starts, domestic violence is undoubtedly a human rights issue and a serious deterrent to development. And then it goes on to mention what was the inspiration. A, the Vienna Accord of 1994. B, the Beijing Declaration. And the Platform for Action 1995. All these 3 have acknowledged that domestic violence really needs a very serious contemplation on the part of the legislators. And lastly, which is actually, I think, in my mind, the most important and the most popular precursor to this act, was the CEDAW, what we call the CEDAW, and is the full form is the United Nations Committee on Convention on Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, CEDAW, CEDAW. And it mentions that in a general recommendation, it recommended that all the state parties should act to protect women against violence of any kind, especially that which is occurring within the family. So as you can see, the focus is within the family, within the restricted space, four walls, that is the focus. Now, to the just a quick word on the CEDAW. Is the CEDAW was adopted by the UN General Assembly, United Nations General Assembly, sometime in 1979, if I'm not mistaken, and was alternatively called, still referred to, as the International Bill of Rights for Women. And what it does is it sets out a very comprehensive set of rights for women in practically all areas, you know, whether it's civil, political, economic, social, cultural, you name it. And the general recommendations were made, I think, sometime earlier. It was 1989. And what it did for India is it really based itself on Articles 14, 15, and 21. 14, you know, it's discrimination, equality. 15, rights, broad-based rights of, you know, religion, race, creed, caste, creed, etc. And 21, of course, right to life and livelihood. So next section, I hope I'm just flowing seamlessly from one section to the other because there are 2 esteemed speakers after me. I don't want to waste any time at all. The next section I would dwell on is how has the Supreme Court seen or visited this the Domestic Violence Act in its recent decisions, and why to me this is important for all of you, is that the Supreme Court actually did a great thing. It played a very important role in there was this act, but what the Supreme Court did was it broadened certain very important sections of the Act, whether it was Section 3, whether it was type of domestic violence, who could complain, who is a victim, etc. So just to give you an example, the first case was Lalita TOPPO, T-O-P-P-O, versus State of Jharkhand. That was 2009-13 SCC 796. And it was three-judge bench. Yes, it was three-judge bench. In this case, the Supreme Court, what was important is that the Supreme Court observed that even a live-in partner can seek maintenance under the 2005 Act. And it made this observation while actually considering a reference to it from a two-judge bench on the scope of section 125 of the CRPC, which is the maintenance section. And it was held, the Supreme Court held, that, it was an observation actually, that the petitioner in this case, in that case, before the Supreme Court, Lalitha Tokpo, would have an effective, efficacious remedy to seek maintenance under the Act, even assuming that she is not the legally wedded wife and was not entitled to maintenance under Section 125. Very important, you know. I mean, nowadays, this whole concept of marriage, who would want to live together, whether you're sharing benefits, everything has undergone a change, and it's a very, very progressive way of looking at the Act. The next section, the next case, I'm sorry, is Ajay Kumar versus Latha, which is of 2019, 5 SCC 352. I am giving the citations for the benefit of those who would really care to write it down, not necessary otherwise. That was of Justice Chandrachud, sitting with Justice Gupta. In that case, the Supreme Court upheld an order passed under the Domestic Violence Act directing a brother-in-law to pay maintenance to a widow. In that case, the lady and her deceased husband were residing in the house, which constituted the ancestral Hindu joint family property. And the deceased husband and the brother-in-law jointly carried on a business of, you know, some sort of a store. And the woman filed a complaint under the Act, alleging that after the death of her husband, she and her child were not permitted to live in the matrimonial home. The trial court passed an order, you know, with regard to maintenance or something. I don't remember that part really. And what the Supreme Court did was the brother-in-law was directed to pay the amount to the woman as well as to the child, and held that brother-in-law, quote unquote, can also be subject to a direction of payment of maintenance. And in that decision, section 2Q, the Supreme Court, that's what the Supreme Court held. Section 2Q of the Domestic Violence Act, section 2Q deals with respondent, and that's a definition section, 2Q respondent, and says means any adult male person who is or has been in a domestic relationship with the aggrieved person and against whom the aggrieved person has sought any relief under the Act. So the Supreme Court indicated that section 2Q and the expression respondent means any adult person, so, you know, doesn't have to be restricted to a husband. So the brother-in-law came under that that provision, section 2Q. The next is Kamlesh Devi versus Jaipal. That's of 2019, the decision. There of Justice Indira Banerjee, sitting with Justice M.R. Shah. The Supreme Court in that case upheld the dismissal of a domestic violence complaint filed by a woman against persons who were not living with her in the shared household. A woman in complaint against certain persons claiming that her relatives living in the same premises were harassing and abusing her daughters. And it had come from the Punjab and Haryana High Court. And the Supreme Court upheld the High Court decision and observed that the High Court had rightly found that the ingredients of domestic violence are absent in this case, and the petitioner and the respondents are not persons living together in a shared household. So now you see there's a balancing act here, you know. I mean, not all complaints, not every allegation of harassment would pass or would go through the prism of what would constitute an offense or violence under the Act. So it's a very nice balancing act the Supreme Court did. The second, the third decision is Shom Nikhil Danani versus Tanya Bannon Danani. That's of 2019. I just tried to look at the recent cases, and I'm grateful to my law clerk and my interns for that. That of course, that is also of Justice Chandrachud. And sitting with Justice Chandrachud, sitting with Justice Indira Banerjee, there the Supreme Court observed that mere passing of a maintenance order under Section 125, in that case, the matter had gone from the Delhi High Court. What the Supreme Court held was that mere passing of a maintenance order under Section 125, the CRPC, cannot bar or does not bar an aggrieved person from seeking appropriate relief under the Domestic Violence Act. And in fact, the view of the Supreme Court, I'll just quickly read it out for your benefit. Interesting. It's that we are of the view that the High Court of Delhi was justified in coming to the conclusion that mere passing of an order under Section 125 of the CRPC does not preclude the respondent from seeking appropriate reliefs under the Domestic Violence Act. Therefore, it's why is this decision important? Because, you know, a very common strategy amongst litigants, amongst lawyers, and sometimes the bench also is persuaded by that argument, is that once you have taken the benefit of a relief under a particular statute, you are automatically debarred from seeking a relief from another statute, you know, which is of more or less of a similar import or seeks to protect similar rights of a woman or of any aggrieved class for that matter. So in this case, I thought that this decision was important, that, you know, I mean, just because you've come under the CRPC 125 doesn't mean that you do not get protection under the Domestic Violence Act. So that I thought that was quite important. I've selected some of the decisions, and the other one is Megha Khandelwal versus Rajat Khandelwal, 2019. It was of Justice N. Khanvilkar and sitting with Justice Rastogi, Ajay Rastogi. There, the Supreme Court passed an order where the interim maintenance to a wife was substantially enhanced. It was a case of domestic violence. And the Supreme Court was of the view that it doesn't matter whether the wife was educated, well-educated, or, you know, could provide for herself, have a good job, was capable of having a good job. The Supreme Court said that doesn't matter, you know, you have to pay the maintenance and enhance that amount. Again, a very, very significant development, I would say, you know. So not that, you know, you're just kind of down and out as a wife, and then you go to a court and the court says that, you're not entitled to monetary relief. The next one is Rajesh Sharma versus Union of India. That's of 2017. That's the citation is 2018, 10 SCC 472. That is of Justice Goel, A.K. Goel. And in that case, the Supreme Court directed that the establishment of family welfare committees in each district by the DLSA, that's the District Legal Services Authority, would have to look into each and every complaint filed in the district under Section 498A. And the court further proceeded to direct that no arrest should be made in the matter, in any matter, unless the committee received a report to that effect. And this was important actually to also to check this, whether it is Section 498A or 304B or even the 2005 Act. Sometimes you will see that, rampant complaints are filed without, the police or the other magistrates or the authorities going into the details whether they should be filed or they can be filed at all or not. So in that case, in that sense, the Supreme Court gave an important direction. So that's really all the cases the cases which were brought to my notice. The next area quickly is, are there any points to ponder? I mean, is there a space for all of you to sit back and think that whether this is a complete legislation or not? Any legislation is bound to have windows for improvement. So what are those windows in this act, under this act? The first window, I would say, is, after the Supreme Court in Navtej Singh Johar, which looked at the rights of the LGBTQ community, I would say that the Domestic Violence Act really needs to sit back and have a relook. Section 2 of the Act, why do I say that? Okay, so Section 2 of the Act clearly defines who an aggrieved party is and makes it absolutely clear that an aggrieved party is a female and the accused is a male. It's clear, it's unambiguous, those are the expressions in the Act. So aggrieved person, female, accused male. That's the 2005 Act. Now, when you look at the rights of the LGBTQ community and in the framework or in the background of Navtej Singh Johar's judgment, then I think, common sense would dictate that, you really can't say anymore that male, female, that kind of juxtaposition, that kind of tension of the genders, that really needs to go, because everything needs to be looked at in a new light. And I don't really want to dwell too much on the Supreme Court judgments as to what it held in Navtej Singh Johar, because that would really eat into the time of my fellow speakers. I don't want to do that, but suffice it to say that if you look into the rights and the whole conspectus of the issues which form the rights of the LGBTQ community, I would think that who is an aggrieved, who is an accused, who is a victim, male, female, that really has become dated. So that definitely needs, we really need to do something about that. And what are the issues which the legislation has missed? What are the other issues? One of the issues would be that the Domestic Violence Act does not really mention spiritual abuse. When I say spiritual abuse, it's probably oxymoronic in that sense. Spiritual abuse, not very frequently used, the expression. But, suppose a woman by her husband is forced to practice certain religious norms or is manipulated by her husband, by the accused, to practice of certain religion, or is prevented from practicing a religion. As you know, it's all about not only commission but also omission. Or if a woman is ridiculed by her husband, ridiculed of her religious beliefs, of the rituals she follows or she does, or if she is forced to put her children or rear her children in a particular faith, which he believes, you know, any kind of these kinds of activities or acts that I would think would come under the umbrella of spiritual abuse, which does not find mention in the 2005 Act. The other area, which probably is another a gap in the Act, is the option of mediation. The Section 18A, for example, of the Domestic Violence Act in Australia expressly provides for the option or referring the parties to mediation whenever there is an incident of domestic violence. Now, I completely agree, or I completely acknowledge the fact that mediation may not be the answer, and in fact may be a very unsatisfactory answer to any incident of domestic violence. But what is important is that the option must be there, the choice, you know. I mean, now mediation is something which has become really very popular, and you know, the Commercial Courts Act makes it mandatory, Section 12A, it is, I think, many of the acts makes mediation absolutely mandatory. So perhaps, you know, why not the Domestic Violence Act? The third the absence of the Act in following certain rules. Now, what would these rules be? Which would include the 2006 rules, which come with the Act. That's the Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Rules, 2006, which provides for various things, you know, procedural safeguards, really. For example, like a domestic incidents report, like a safety plan, that you know, upon receiving a complaint of domestic violence, what would be a safety plan? You know, what are the next steps? So there is not enough focus, or there is not enough stress, I would say, on the Act or in the Act of following these rules, even though the rules are there, the rules are in place. And I was looking into various decisions. One of the things which struck me was the courts also, you know, there is definitely room for recognizing other relationships, you know. The Act only looks at mother, sister, single women. I mean, there are tons of other relationships which can be brought under the purview of the Act. So that is something which the bar, when they are coming to the court, the bench, when they are dealing with these kinds of cases, that is something definitely which can be considered. The other thing is recognizing economic, social, verbal, and emotional abuse. You know, abuse is something which I don't even have to elaborate on this or explain what you know, the very many forms which abuse can take. It's not, you know, pushing someone or slapping someone or, you know, any kind of physical infraction into somebody else's space. It can be, you know, even silence, a complete and a deliberate decision to not act in a certain situation, even looks, smiles, laughter, everything, you know, everything can take on the form of an abuse. So that is something also which I did not find too many decisions on that. So probably we have to look forward to these kinds of decisions coming into place, which would take into these situations in its fold. And the last thing I would think is, you know, establishing a link between a bad marriage and domestic violence. So I really would look forward to a decision where this distinction is made by a court, you know, that bad marriage and domestic violence, is there a necessity to carve out that, to make a wall? Or is there space under the Act or in the common law jurisprudence to say that there is a very thin line where a bad marriage can quickly take on the shades of domestic violence. So, you know, these are just thoughts, just random thoughts, where you know, any kind of decision in that space would really be welcome. And quickly to the other side, I have promised that I cannot ignore the other side. You know, some of my best friends and my, you know, people who inspire me are men, extremely liberal, very understanding, completely, you know, appreciative of an understanding of what constitutes domestic violence. So I would really feel that this would be an unfortunate result of the act if men, well-meaning men, innocent men, who have not, you know, when I go on saying men, it's kind of a self-defeating, you know, I'm going against what I said just now, that, you know, the abuser, it really needs to be seen that this act is not misused. So how do we prevent that? There are two cases I found where this has actually been taken care of by the court. One is dealing with malicious prosecution. That is in Bharti Ben Bipin Bhai Tanboli versus State of Gujarat. The court was actually pleased to red flag that, you know, vexatious proceedings are being filed and can be filed misusing the provisions of the Act. And actually the High Court held that, you know, people are misusing the provisions just to drag and harass and, you know, kind of, you know, torture husbands and in-laws and relatives, even where cases are, you know, in vague cases, no particulars, nothing, you know, as I mentioned that case, relatives living in some other city, but a complaint was nonetheless filed. And the Supreme Court also clarified somewhere, now I've forgotten where, is that the act is really meant for upliftment of a class or group of women who have women in that gender, that space, who have had a history of oppression and who have had a history of suffering discrimination. So the act has to be looked really at in a very progressive light, not in a regressive light where it is misused to such an extent that, you know, the courts itself become wary, and the police and the magistrates, the law enforcers, they become wary and they look at each complaint with, you know, with suspicion, which really goes on to, you know, which is so counterproductive against what the act really intends to be. So that I don't want to get on any more with I would love to hear what Justice Dalvin, what Justice Joshi have to say on this. But just one line before I end is that, you know, when I was going through the provisions, I just realized that Domestic Violence Act, you know, it really demolishes the traditional concept of a home. And while it is a very sad development, you know, that the law, that a law had to be enacted to protect women from their most secure space, which is home. You know, I was also thinking of, you know, no discussion can be complete without a look at what we are going through, at the extraordinary time which we are going through now, the COVID-19, the pandemic period. And, you know, I just read somewhere that as opposed to, I think, 12 or 16 cases of domestic violence complaints filed in the first week of March, there were, I think, almost 200 cases filed in the third week of March. And remember, the lockdown happened from 24th March. And that is so very unfortunate because, you know, the COVID time, there is a restriction on moving outside the house. And in a typical case of domestic violence, if the victim is restrained from going out of the house, then where does she go? Who does she go and make the complaint to? You know, there has to be this movement outside the house. But because of this peculiar times which we are all going through, you know, there is a bar to that extent. So whatever is happening inside the house, is there is complete underreporting of these cases, which is a complete cause of worry, cause for worry for me at a personal level. And you know, we can all see the reasons behind it. You know, people are losing jobs, or if not losing, their jobs are in an uncertain space. They don't know what's going to happen in the coming months. There is a tremendous pressure of housework. There's a tremendous pressure of staying in the home within the four walls, all the family together. And it's not a very happy thing all the time, you know, if all the entire family is together, it can be actually lead to a lot of friction. So the reasons, the causes for domestic violence are easy to see. But what we must really look for and look after is that in these times, in the pandemic space, you know, we should really encourage people to come forward and report these cases. Or even if you're not seeing them yourself, if you've heard of it, if you're hearing all kinds of suspicious noises from your neighbors, from your other houses, reading WhatsApp messages, please kindly come and report. So thank you very much for a very patient hearing to the points which I had to bring forward. And over to the other speakers. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Over to Justice Roshan Dalvi. We will not talk much now because, as we said, the time is the essence. Yes, over to you, ma'am.
Yes, Justice Bhattacharya and Justice Joshi and my friends. Good afternoon.
I'm only one thing, Justice S. Vimla has also joined from Madras High Court.
Was that?
Justice Vimla from Madras High Court has also joined us.
Okay, Justice Nirmala also.
Vimla, ma'am. She knows you. She said that they've met in the Judicial Academy, Bhopal.
Oh, yes. I've met so many people at Judicial Academy, I forget them. Okay. Now, see, I just want to tell you, give you a purview of this DV Act. The judge has already spoken about the judgments and the sections and what else should be done. How did this idea come about and when did it happen? 44 years ago, when I was a lawyer, between 44 and about 50 years ago, I was interested in paralegal training and especially for women and children. So we had a domestic violence workshop sort of. There was no act at that time. This expression of domestic violence was not in fashion at that time. But there were many women who were beaten up, you can say. These belong to the lower classes, to the rural areas, to people who cannot access justice. And we said that something must be done for them. We had an activity in one of our workshops like this. And we told them, you write down on a piece of paper, what are the things that you do during the day? And then we told them, okay, now turn the paper and write down what are the things that your husband does during the day. So they wrote down several things, about 11, 12, 14 for themselves, and about 3, 4, 5 for the husband. Some of them said, he takes my children to the school bus. Some of them said, he irons, he packs the tiffin box, etc. And all of the other domestic chores, as well as the work that they were doing in offices and all, everything was on the women's side. Now, these women were under the impression that if they make a mistake, their husbands can beat them up. So they actually asked us, madam, jo hum bhul kare aur humko mare, to hum kuch nahi bole. Lekin hum bhul nahi kare and to bhi mare, to hum kya bole, madam? So we understood this new perspective and we told them, see, even if you make a mistake, you have to be scolded at the most, you have to be told, you don't have to be beaten up. And therefore we told them, keep this paper that you have written yourself with you. And next time your husband beats you up, show him this paper and ask him, I do all these things. Is that not enough? You do all these things. Can you do nothing more? And then you see the appreciation for your work, which he has definitely misread or not, or sort of not seen at all. And this was the kind of people and the group that the act wanted to protect and give them access to justice. Now consider the laws which were there earlier. 498A, for example, it dealt with mental harassment and cruelty. But under the United Nations Charter, under various other legislations of various Western countries, there was economic violence, emotional violence, psychological violence also, which we had to incorporate in our law. Now, that having been done, what happened was that the cases naturally increased. And the Act mentions about mediation. And the judge has mentioned about mediation, so I might want to elaborate a little bit on that. That our Act says that you can go for mediation anytime the magistrate can send you. So there was a government notification and circular that unless there is a magistrate's sending order, you cannot go for mediation. Now, there are many women's groups, like, for example, Majlis, Lawyers Collective, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, etc. And the person who actually filed a petition before us challenging this notification, they say that women come to us to say that there is domestic violence. They don't want to put an end to the relationship, absolutely. They may have children, they may have other things. They want this. They only want us to impress upon their husband that they can live in peace, that they should not be thrown out of the matrimonial home, etc., etc. Now, therefore, we passed the judgment. We set aside that notification, Chief Justice Mohit Shah and myself. It is reported in 2015 Supreme Bombay. And what we said was that's a case of Jaya Sagre versus State of Maharashtra. We said you can go at any time for mediation because it is enabling. It is not a disabling provision. And therefore, you can settle your dispute. Now, when that happens, what is the real result? That the woman does not take the man for arrest and other things. But if you don't allow that, and the Domestic Violence Act being there, she may want to do that. And therefore, all these maladies, if at all they are really maladies, come about. So it is good that we give the women some access to justice, and we then make them enabled to take up all their issues. Now, you see, when you go to the family court, there is reconciliation and mediation and counseling and all of those things. But everyone cannot access the family court. Family court is one or two in a district. So you have to go to that district. Therefore, the Domestic Violence Act allows you to go to the magistrate's court because then everyone can access justice. Now you see the laudable provision, people who cannot come there. Now when she goes before a magistrate's court, the husband doesn't want her anymore. And he goes to the family court and he files a petition under the Hindu Marriage Act or Special Marriage Act or whatever. Then she comes back again to the family court because now she has to come to the family court. So she doesn't want to go again to the magistrate's court. And therefore, if she has to get any relief, especially maintenance, because generally it is the maintenance, she is given in the family court as an interim measure when the husband has filed the petition. Now, we understand that several things can be used and misused. And therefore, we put upon ourselves certain restrictions. So there are certain rules framed in the Bombay High Court where we said that if a domestic violence report is filed, you've gone to the magistrate's court, you applied for maintenance, the magistrate has given you some modicum of maintenance, and then you're coming to the family court and again making another application for maintenance, then we have told the magistrates and judges, we train them for that, and we tell them, see, under the law, under Section 26, she is entitled to apply in all the courts, but you cannot give the same relief in all the courts. Therefore, then you take up that application for final relief only. So that at the final hearing, she has to give her evidence, the husband will lead her his evidence, and then it can be once and for all decided. So there are various checks and balances in mediation and in management. This is management of the DV courts, I would say. There are other things where, just as the legislature takes notice of so many matters where women could be beaten up, etc., the judiciary takes notice. Now, what is judicial notice? That there can be repeat violence. Therefore, if there is serious physical violence, we say, stop. The woman is entitled to her matrimonial home or to the shared residence. She is entitled to maintenance. She may be entitled to custody of children. Whatever that you can work out with, you cannot tell her to reconcile. But in every other case, we always recommend reconciliation. And reconciliation is not only going and living together happily ever after, because that can't be done in so many cases. So, amicable divorce. Now, as a retired judge, when I get consultancy matters and then I'm doing mediation, I take up all these things together. And I have seen that so many cases which begin with domestic violence complaint end with a 13B petition. So that all the things can be worked out and then parties go and file a 13B petition and everything is settled. Now, I'll tell you one last thing, that there are abusers, you say. There are so many women who abuse. Yes, everyone abuses laws. All our social legislations are abused. It is for the court to see that this abuse doesn't take place. Therefore, in those kind of cases, we don't pass orders in favor of women. We acquit the man if suppose there is a complaint and it has gone through the evidence. Okay. Now, I had a very interesting case before me. A woman said that she is entitled to her shared residence. Correct? Absolutely correct under Section 90. The husband said, I am prepared to give her an alternative accommodation in the same locality where we have a row house. But the woman says, no, I want a share in this very same household only. Now, under Section 19(1)(b) of the DV Act, if you read both these sections, 17 and 19(1)(b) together, alternative residence can be given. Husband has very fairly offered it. I say, you please go so that your violence will come to an end. If you are alleging violence, you will get your own separate house. But she refused to accept. And I refused to give her any order for shared residence of that same residence only. So she actually got nothing. Because of course the husband kept his offer open. And I said, if she comes along, you please give her. But I am not going to give her that because that is to the exclusion of this. She insists on this only. So I can't. So there are very many such cases. They may not even be reported. In fact, there are so many of these cases which are not reported. But they end in acquittal. They end in orders against the women, etc. But we must not lose fact of the main thing, that men are capable of violating women. That is universal. It is universal and it must be addressed. And therefore, we have the DV Act. So if there is actually serious physical violence, nothing except taking her out of that situation. Otherwise, all other orders, all other settlements can go through. That is the sum and substance. Even in this Rakesh Sharma's case, where the Supreme Court said there is the abuse of the law and therefore there must be different procedures, etc. The last line of that, various things that they said could be done was that this will not apply to the case of tangible physical violence. I rest at that. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. It was very short and crisp and to the point. As they say, brevity is the soul of good speaking or writing skills. I will request, since as time and again we are saying, I would request Justice Shalini to give the insights.
Yes, thank you, Justice Moshami, Justice Roshan, Justice Vimla, most welcome. I'm happy that we are again sharing the platform, not in the National Judicial Academy, but at least virtual platform. So it is an interesting subject of domestic violence. There are views, counter views, used, misused. But first thing we have to remember is that Domestic Violence Act is not a criminal type of offense, criminal nature of the legislation. Here the criminal nature will come only in Section 30, that is violation of protection order. The Domestic Violence Act itself was enacted to provide civil remedies. Now, civil remedies which were earlier not available to a woman, and that is because of the peculiar nature of the laws in our country. In the sense that we don't have the concept of matrimonial home or property in community. Like in common law, there are two systems of civil laws. One is about the British common law and other is continental law. Under the continental law, they have the system of property in community, after the marriage, the property of both the spouses is joined, merged together, and therefore after the divorce or desertion or whatever may be separation of ways, the property is equally devolved between them. We don't have that concept, and therefore what is happening is a woman may not have her own property, and therefore divorce or desertion affects or is most detrimental to woman because she doesn't get any right after the divorce or desertion in the property of her husband. And that may have become the reason why the concept of matrimonial home assumes significance. And Lord Denning has recognized it as a deserted woman's right in equity, meaning thereby her non-economic contribution in the upbringing of the children, in the household activities, needs to be recognized. Even if we cannot recognize it in monetary way by paying her something, but her right to reside in the matrimonial home should be acknowledged. The Supreme Court has acknowledged that right in the case of Piretti, and it was in 2005, before this judgment came, it was in 2000. B.P. Achala Prasad versus Appi Reddy. Supreme Court said that, yes, she has got that right. But then we don't have Matrimonial Homes Act that is in England or in UK or in several other countries they have where right of wife to reside in matrimonial home is recognized. And therefore, it was thought fit that in Domestic Violence Act, we should recognize that right. That Domestic Violence Act doesn't give her any right of ownership, any equitable, it just recognizes her right of residence. If she is residing in that house, yes, she is entitled to continue to reside. But as Justice Roshan Dalvi has said, that if husband is making some alternate accommodation which is reasonable, suitable, just like the previous one where she was residing, then she is expected to go there also. So the entire object of providing the civil remedies was to protect her from domestic violence. And the concept of domestic violence, we have to recognize and acknowledge in the sense that it is different from any other sort of violence because it happens within the four walls of the house. Earlier section 498A of IPC was there, but it used to be available only when she was driven out of the house. Again, it was a criminal offense and therefore arrest and lot of apprehensions of misuse. And therefore this Domestic Violence Act provides only and mostly civil remedies. Now we are granting some injunction for her to continue to reside in the house and for husband not to subject her to domestic violence, and in that way we try to protect her in her own house. That is the entire object of the act. If we see the provisions of the act, like section 36, it clearly says that this act is not in derogation of any other law, but in addition to. And therefore we are having the other rights of maintenance, residence, and all those rights like custody of children also she can seek under this provision, under this act. But all these measures are of temporary nature. If ultimately she has to prove her right of ownership or right of, title in the said property, she has to again go to regular civil court like any other property law, her right will be decided. If she wants the permanent custody of the child, she will have to go to regular court. Even for maintenance, other provisions are there. And if she has already been given maintenance in those provisions, then only if something is lacking, which we feel that she is entitled to, then only under this provision it can be granted. But we have to remember that Domestic Violence Act is only providing civil remedies mostly. And secondly, whatever remedies are provided, they are more or less of interim nature in the sense that immediately after coming out of the house, she should not be shelterless, she should not be homeless, she should have some roof on her head. And that is the entire object of this act. After we can, and that is because to protect, uphold her individual dignity. I mean, it is so important. We do not even use the stick if any teacher uses the stick in the school to our child, we go to the school and confront the teacher. And the entire intention is that physical abuse, economic, emotional abuse, really, it is an insult to the individual dignity of a human being, whether he is a child, whether he is a man, whether he is a woman. And it was found necessary. I mean, this act has come in 2005. Now it is 2020. Therefore, about 15 years have lapsed in between. And during that time, again, the society has changed. Again, the perceptions have changed. But when this act was enacted, I mean, the survey was conducted, the necessity was assessed. And even now, I mean, if you see the various data, which I would like to definitely highlight, that the finding, I mean, finding of the survey conducted by United Nations Population Fund International Center for Research and Women in 2017 and 18 revealed that 52% of women reported that they had experienced some form of violence during their lifetime from husband or intimate partners, and 60% men said that they had acted violently against their wife or partner at some point in their lives. NCRB data also reflects that every 22 minutes one case of domestic violence takes place. Whereas according to WHO report, violence against women causes more death than all the illnesses put together. As per the latest data, in every three women, one woman is a subject of domestic violence. Moreover, the survey of National Family Health in the year 2015-16 also shows that 42% men surveyed believed that it is justified for a man to beat his wife for as trifle a reason as she did not cook properly or refused to have sex or neglected her household duties. Therefore, point to be stressed is that sometimes, I mean, it is as per current scenario, it is the women who are more subjected to domestic violence. Some cases are also being reported of men being subjected to domestic violence, but that is a different issue because in 2005, when this act was enacted, I mean, as I said again, 15 years have lapsed at that time, and to some extent today also, it is the women who are being subjected to domestic violence. And therefore, sometimes there are certain myths and realities also as to why women continues to reside in these relationships. The problem is that such violent relationship has also toxic effects on her. It not only causes physical damage to her, physical hurt to her, but it affects her confidence, it affects her dignity, it affects her individuality in every way. And she feels that where I will go, my parents, whether they will accept me, society, whether it will accept me, whether, you know, my children, what to do about them, at least they have some roof on their head. Sometimes there is flower and shower case also, husband promises next time he will improve and she also believes him. Woman is the last person, I mean, in the home, the home which she has built, which she has brought to such an extent and where she has devoted everything. She doesn't want, I mean, to break or to destroy that home, and therefore every effort sometimes she makes and society also makes. I mean, the act legislature has also, as Justice Roshan Dalvi has rightly said, the legislature has made provision for counseling in section 14 of the act to ensure that the dispute can be really resolved with mediation by the help of expert counselors. Therefore, it is not that no one makes the efforts to save the home. On the contrary, every effort is made to save the home by all the sections of the strata of the society. And thereafter only if, as Justice Dalvi has said, that in case of really physical violence only, the court takes action like, you know, restraining the husband from entering home or the protection order, etc. There are several checks and balances just to put the record straight. Though in the case of Rajesh Sharma, the Supreme Court has directed for establishment of family welfare committee and not to arrest the, but that the decision has been reviewed by the Supreme Court itself in the judgment of Social Action Forum for Manav Adhikar versus Union of India. That is 2018, 10 Supreme Court cases, 443, wherein Supreme Court has held that constitution of family welfare committees is impermissible and directions as regards arrest also held to be against the provisions of CRPC. So every time there is review of even own judgments passed by the Supreme Court to ensure that law keeps the pace with the time, the law keeps the pace with the social changes. But when this act was enacted, and today also, considering the constitutional promise, which is of contained in Article 15.3, Article 21, it was felt that it is the women who are subjected to domestic violence. They are in more in number, and therefore some act has to be there. I was also looking at the other, the laws in other countries, because it is a common perception that we don't have, to have laws only for women. And therefore I went to it. There is certain recent progress, and I have found that in Spain, they are having, Istanbul Convention, International Convention is also talking about it, that there can be laws for domestic violence law can be gender neutral. The Spain is having such law. So who knows, as the time goes, as the society progresses, we may have revisit these laws, we may relook at these laws. But for the time being, the law, the way it is interpreted, reinterpreted, and several times even the relationship in the nature of marriage, that is also well defined now in the case of D. Velusamy in 2010, against in the case of Indra Sharma in 2013, the Supreme Court has laid down various criteria, and it was clearly held that if both the parties should be eligible, capable, competent for marriage, then only such relationship will be recognized. So Supreme Court has, laid down, what I mean to say is that how the law should not be, properly used for women or for anyone, and it should not be misused. But in response to the current time scenario, if the requirement was failed of this law, then considering Article 15.3 of the Constitution and 21 of the Constitution, such a law, when it was brought, it was considered really, revolutionary sort of things. Now we have started accepting it, implementing it, and it is required for those women who are really in need of the same. What we see sometimes may be misused, as several times it is brought up. It may be it may not be in such a way, because we don't have any statistical data or empirical data on this aspect. So let us see how this law further progresses and how this law evolves and how these laws come to be interpreted. But as I said, when it was enacted and for the present also, it appears to be a necessary socio-legal beneficial piece of legislation. And as regards other aspects of the law, I think both the speakers have elaborated thereon, and therefore I will rest my case here. Thank you.
Justice Vimla. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
Keeping the time constraint and putting the things is also an art, which we say that is required in the judicial setup. Maybe it is a lawyer, maybe it is a judge. Since we have Justice Vimla also, we would like her also to give a short insights, because we will be opening up the chat box for the purposes of questions, because we had certain questions, I had certain questions received on the WhatsApp also. So we will take up a few questions, but we will all restrict ourselves within the parameters of the time constraint. We have unmuted Justice Vimla to have her insights.
Thank you, Vikas. I thank all the participants. And a very kaleidoscopic presentation by all the three sister judges. Therefore, nothing special to add, excepting one thing. Sister Shalini was pointing out that it is predominantly a civil remedy is provided under the Domestic Violence Act. As pointed out, Justice Bhattacharya, when there was provision only under 498A, and the woman prefers to go to police station to prefer a complaint. And if in case the husband meet out an unfair treatment at the hands of the police, reunion becomes an impossibility. And as this act provides predominantly a civil remedy, it is better in the interest of the women to invoke the provisions of this Domestic Violence Act seeking for the civil remedy, so that ultimately if the women wants to join and they can get a better remedy. Already three sister judges have presented it very elaborately and to the point. And therefore, it may not be fair for me to add anything more. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Justice Vimla. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, we are opening the chat box. Meanwhile, certain questions have come on the WhatsApp. I'll be taking just since Justice Moshmi had set the webinar into motion. Why, when making acts or laws by researching foreign laws, our lawmakers had ignored the general neutral provisions? For example, DV Act was made only for women, whereas most of the world has its gender neutral. Do you believe in this?
I'm just repeating the question, Mr. Chhatrath. Is the question that...
question is, he says, I can put it in my own words.
Yes,
he
yes.
says that all laws are invariably the foreign laws, yes. are gender neutral laws.
Yes,
whereas
yes.
in our case of the DV Act, it is more woman centric.
Yes, yes.
What is your take on that?
Well, unfortunately, yes. I mean, that was one of the points which I covered, that... The victim and the abuser, I will just give you exactly what the provision is. It says that the respondent is the respondent in a domestic relationship with the aggrieved person. And is the adult male person. So says adult male person. And when it comes to definition, section 2A of the Act says aggrieved person means any woman who is or has been in a domestic relationship with a respondent. And respondent is 2Q, says adult male person. So as I said, it's very clearly defined and very... very unambiguous in that sense, male and female. So I think that my take on that would be it's a lacuna in the Act as to why these provisions or Section 2, the definition clauses, have not been made gender neutral. But having said that, I also believe that any Indian legislation, any Indian enactment would necessarily be a product of Indian history, Indian culture, and the way Indian society is or was, and would necessarily be reflective of it. So an act will be successful to the extent that it seeks to correct or remedy or rectify those situations. So what we have seen in India is that domestic violence has been perpetrated by the male, adult male, to the woman. So therefore, that is the direction. And therefore, the law, when it was enacted, notwithstanding all its foreign precursors, took into account the most common, the most recognized aspects of domestic violence and who perpetrates it and who suffers it. So in that sense, I think it is a very Indian contextual situation, a contextual act. And as I said, after Navpreet Singh Johar and a whole lot of other judgments, which looks into other communities, which looks into gender neutral possibilities, the way society is developing, I'm sure there will be other decisions as well, which would give a very neutral color to these provisions. Thank you.
Next question, I'm asking Justice Roshan Talvi to give the insights. How can you say that men don't experience domestic violence or experience very less violence? Justice Shalini can give the insights, probably Justice Roshan. Yes, Roshan Talvi is unmuted. This question is for Justice Roshan Talvi. The question is, how can you say that the men don't experience domestic violence? Is there any data or police don't take complaints of women, from men?
I never said that the men don't experience domestic violence. The men may be experiencing, I do not know. I do not know how many men come up with a black eye or with a fractured bone or any such thing. And they can go to the criminal court in any case. And we would have those cases. This act is meant for women. because at that time the position was that women should be protected from domestic violence. Therefore, we have to uphold the act. But if you want to extend it to the male, you have to go to the parliament, get another act, or amend this act.
This is, we can ask, we are asking Justice Shalini, why is section 340 slash 344 not used when it is proved that the complaint was false?
It is definitely used in deserving cases. There is no bar in using it, but the case should be deserving. I mean, you should be, there should be material on the record to show that complaint was false, vexatious, and court should be moved for that purpose by the party who is aggrieved, and they should show that, yes, they should ask the court to take such action. And if the, it is in discretion of the court, if the court finds, yes, it is false, the court will take action. It is not that it is not taken as such.
Mr. Chhatrat, if I can just come in for a second. At this,
yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. It's an open.
You know, I mean, not really to add to what Justice Joshi said, which is of course a very is the reality. From I think 2010, there was a judgment of the Supreme Court, Preeti Gupta versus State of Jharkhand, 2010, to the most recent one, which I found was Shamlal Devda versus Parimala of 2020. Where, you know, the Supreme Court actually took into account vague allegations which have not been proved, as in Preeti Gupta. And in Shamlal, it was a case of, I think, the respondents were living in, you know, Rajasthan and somewhere else, Gujarat, and the wife was somewhere else. So the Supreme Court said that it's not possible for these people to inflict this kind of violence on you. So, you know, the courts, you know, luckily for everybody concerned, have taken these situations into account, you know, where false cases may be filed.
Ma'am, thank you. Since Justice Vimla is also there, one question is, let's assume we find that the woman has taken a false maintenance. Is there any remedy for claiming that as a refund?
You mean maintenance alone?
Maintenance alone.
There is no, there cannot be any case of false claim for maintenance, maybe an exaggerated claim sometimes. But though there are many provisions under many enactment, ultimately when a question of implementation comes, it is a big zero to women. As if they are the accused, they come and ask and beg before the court that there is an order which is not implemented. Implementation is very, very difficult. Maybe it is a paper order that they enjoy, not the real payment of maintenance to them.
This is a question which had already been taken up in one of the webinars. It says that in a case, this is open to all four of you, in a case under Section 3 of the Dowry Prohibition Act, when two parties commit a crime of giving and taking a dowry, why is only one party, that is a dowry taking party, booked in FIR, but not the other party? Does it require an amendment?
I would like to correct it. Section 3 of the Dowry Prohibition Act makes giving and taking both an offense. Therefore, it is both of the persons are offender. That's why, because I checked it immediately and I found that it is an offense. Giving and taking, both is an offense. Section 3.
This is, ma'am, you will just take last two questions. This is by Sandeep. Don't you think narco analysis test and lie detector test should be made compulsory before framing of charges in a court so that the other side does not suffer?
Oh, is this addressed to me?
It's common, anybody can start off.
Okay, I would like to say that this cannot be only under one legislation. If under the Criminal Procedure Code it is allowed, and it has been challenged in the Supreme Court when it was done, so if that is allowed, it would be in all criminal cases, including DV cases.
Okay, and this is, a case was filed under Section 498A and then under the DV Act. Is it a double jeopardy, or both the cases can proceed simultaneously?
Both cases are always taken simultaneously, together only. In fact, even other litigations are now taken together. And that is the beauty of mediation.
Okay. So, ma'am, last question we will be taking.
In fact, Mr. Chhatrat, you know, ma'am. that the case of Danani, Shom Nikhil Danani of 2019, of Justice Chandrachoor sitting with Justice Indira Banerjee, that was one of the points, that whether 125 of the CRPC, if somebody had taken refuge under that, that would debar that person to come under the provisions of the Domestic Violence Act. And the Supreme Court said, no, both can, you can take the benefit of both.
Okay. He says that on one side we are talking of woman empowerment, and on the other side we are encouraging maintenance. How do you maintain the balance between the two?
Yeah.
You can ask Justice Vimla this time.
So, will you please repeat the question?
Ma'am, it says that at one point of time we are asking of woman empowerment, and other also side we are encouraging the maintenance, etc., by providing different acts.
You are the best person to answer that.
No, I'm not hearing. Your voice is breaking. You please.
Ma'am, it says that once we are talking of woman empowerment, and on other time we encourage maintenance. What is your take on that? If I have to answer, ma'am, I will answer it that way. That once, because maintenance is to maintain the balance as such, and once you prove that she's financially sound, etc., in that case, yes. There are litigations. In fact, I'm filing a petition tomorrow itself on one of these grounds only, that once you are able, you are educated, and you have the means and resources, then those all factors have to be taken into consideration while passing the maintenance.
Maybe there are cases where the educated women also come and ask for maintenance. Immediately, they started saying that women is empowered by means of education alone, therefore they are not entitled to maintenance. The question is, even though the woman is educated, whether she has an opportunity to get the employment, that is number one. Even if employed, whether her income is sufficient to maintain her and her children. Mainly when a dispute comes, the children are with the wife or women only, not with the men. And with some cases, the woman is with having small children. When they have kids in the hand, they may not, though educated, they may not be in a position to go for employment and earn money. It's a question of actual earning, sufficient income in her hand. That should be the factor to be considered, and not the mere possession of a degree. How many degree holders are without employment, without income? Only in such cases, the educated women come and ask for maintenance, not all others. Whenever there is a proof that there is sufficient income, maintenance is not granted to women.
I suddenly realized that we have Mr. Ravi also, the district judge from this thing. So let's have a perspective from that way also. We are unmuting Mr. A.S. Ravi. In fact, tomorrow he's joining our webinars. I can put him or to any one of you. Is child abuse by a mother covered under domestic violence or not? Hello. Ma'am, the question, common question is child abuse by mother covered under domestic violence? Ravi? Mr. Ravi? Yeah.
Under the Domestic Violence Act, a woman cannot be a respondent. And therefore, we cannot pass any laws against even the sister-in-law or mother-in-law. Okay. So I don't know which is this very exceptional case of a mother abusing a child, but that can be brought out, but not under the DV Act. You can go under the general law.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
I endorse what my sister Roshan Dalvi is telling. The women cannot be the respondent. There cannot be a case against the mother, even if the child is abused. It should be only under general law, not under Domestic Violence Act.
Under Section 2Q of the Domestic Violence Act, respondent is an adult male. That's the way the respondent has been defined under the Act.
So the crux of the matter, once we complete it, the Parliament has to rethink on the other perspective, but as on, because what we say is in the under the statute that the law has to be considered as what the statute in fact provides for, and it has to be looked and interpreted in the manner in which it is provided. You can't add words, you cannot subtract words, at the most you can do the creasing of the certain words, but as on the situation presently, it is more towards that side. And so we have had questions and we had had the insights on different perspective of law. We are all thankful. So on behalf of Beyond Law CLC and Shobhit University Meerut, we are thankful for the insights having been given by Justice Moshmi Bhattacharya, Justice Roshan Dalvi, Justice Charlie Fitzharker, and Justice Vimla. And we are happy that Justice Vimla joined us and have a different perspective to all this webinar was given. Tomorrow, do stay connected with us in our series of the webinars. Tomorrow, we will be having the topic of different types of stay applications in CPC. And we the insights will be given by Mr. A.S. Ravi, the district judge from Coimbatore. And fortuitously, the other co-participant and speaker would be Mr. A.S. Raja, who is his brother, and who is a principal civil judge in Vellore. So do stay connected and do join with us. And we are again thankful to all the participants who not only joined us on the Zoom platform, as well as on the Facebook. And for some time, we had just kept the chat blocked for the, we felt that the keynote speakers, while they're giving the insights, that gives certain diversion, but we had opened the chat box where the questions were actually to be taken up. Do stay connected with us. Everyone stay healthy, stay blessed, and have a happy life the way we all live. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Without domestic violence.
Without any violence. Why only restrict to domestic violence? Because the society at large has to live more happily. So without violence, they say at the most, even violence of the words in judiciary is considered to be very bad. So why violence anywhere? Thank you, everyone.
That's right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.